Hi, my name's Chris Gideon. I'm a senior premier field engineer with Microsoft. And in this session, we'll be discussing governing SharePoint using content types, policy, and taxonomy services. Over the course of this session, we'll give a brief overview of managed metadata, enterprise keywords, the term store, managed metadata columns, and content type publication. First, let's dive into managed metadata. What is managed metadata? Managed metadata is a hierarchical collection of centrally managed terms that you can define and then use as attributes for items in Microsoft SharePoint Server 2010. In other words, it gives us a way to manage the metadata that's stored along with different objects in SharePoint and reuse it in different locations. Enterprise keywords are the first way that we can start using enterprise managed metadata. Enterprise keywords, which are simply words or phrases that have been added to SharePoint Server 2010 items, all enterprise keywords are part of a single non-hierarchical term set called the keyword set. Enterprise keywords are made available at the time of addition by the enterprise keyword control. This allows a user to use autocomplete, which pulls from the keyword set. This keyword set is a conglomeration of all the terms users have added by adding enterprise keywords and filling that value. These enterprise keywords can be added by the Office 2010 client as well as through Backstage, both methods, and the web browser. Both methods allow for multiple values to be added to items. For those familiar with the beta version of SharePoint 2010, managed keywords are now called enterprise keywords. The enterprise keyword column is not on the document content type out of the box. No site gets it by default. You have to add it explicitly to a document library and view. By default, the social tag store isn't informed about any managed metadata that's added to items. Any managed metadata that you add to items in the list or document library is sent to the term store. When creating a private term set or a site collection specific term set, you're binding a new column to it. It will not be seen from the suggestions user interface except when you are entering a value for the column that's bound to the private term set. However, site collection users can see it when they are working with the term store. For example, when creating a term set viewing site collections term sets. When you create a service, you can say which accounts are allowed to connect to that service and which permissions read-only, read-write, read, and restricted write will be assigned to that specific account. When someone creates a connection, they will tell the service application owner what account the proxy will be using to connect. The service owner modifies the service, adds the account, specifies the account's permission, then tells the person who wants to create the connection the service's published URL. There also exists the possibility of inter-farm consumption. One can create read and restricted write options where a user can read, write new enterprise keywords, add new terms to open term sets, and write new column-specific term sets. However, they cannot manage the service. Users may think, I don't want to type a bunch of metadata. I want to find a person. I want to find other documents by this person. I want to find a document item. I want to find documents and items that discuss the same content as this document item or metadata. However, all of these needs are better facilitated by applying metadata. To make it easier to apply metadata, there are multiple places and methods for users. Users can choose to edit properties on a library item in the browser through folder-based metadata or a business process. Users can also use the document information panel, Backstage, or InfoPath forms. In addition, developers can use the object model to create additional options for applying metadata. This comes down to an easier user-incented approach to add metadata, which will further meet their needs. And now we're going to take a look at a demonstration of applying managed metadata.
In this demonstration, we're going to look at applying metadata through the browser and also through the Office 2010 client to different locations within this particular team site. So right now you see it's a very basic team site, not a lot's been done to it. Well, let's go ahead and go to the document library. You can see I currently only have one document. I have added a couple columns, the created by, title, and version, but not a lot that really shows metadata in this particular library or makes navigation by it any easier. So if I were to just say edit properties, you can see that since those columns haven't been put in, they're really on our lot there. So I'll go to the library settings. I'll come down to columns. I'm going to add from existing site columns. The group I'm going to pick from is the Enterprise Keywords group. Now it's important to note that the Enterprise Keywords might not be supported by earlier versions of client programs, such as earlier versions of Office, and it potentially could block those versions from saving it to this particular document library if they don't have the ability to save to that particular metadata piece if it's required. So I'm going to go ahead and add it to the default view. Okay that. We'll return back to the document library. And now Enterprise Keywords is available. So this time when I come back and edit properties, one of the options that I have is to actually add an enterprise keyword. And since this is about an acquisition, if I start typing, you'll notice that I have different keyword choices appearing for me in the list. So acquisitions is not currently a keyword. So what I'll go ahead and do is add it as a keyword. I'll save it. And now since I had permission to add that particular keyword, it's now currently available. Now another thing I could do if this particular document needed to have a required column, I could add a managed metadata column as well. For right now, let's take a look at let's see what the client experience is in terms of if I check this file out and modify it through the client, my interaction with managed metadata. So let's go ahead and do that. I'll do an edit in Microsoft PowerPoint. And then I'm going to access the backstage. In particular, notice I have enterprise keywords here right now. Let's go ahead and add some others. So we'll add sales or sales management. We'll set it to where salespeople actually understand this is a salesperson might take a look at this particular document and find value. So I'm going to go ahead and tag it with that particular keyword as well. I want to also I could potentially add another author, but either way I'm able to tag it straight from the Office 2010 client. I'm going to go ahead and save it, and then I'm going to exit out of PowerPoint. And when we come back here, you can see that the enterprise keywords have actually been applied. So you've seen how to apply it from both the client, the 2010 clients, and also from the web browser interface.
When we think about how this system is architected, it comes down to the enterprise managed metadata service application, or applications, that each have a database. In addition, the content type hub is controlled through this service application. This makes it much easier to publish the information across farms and manage permissions for the service applications. The Managed Metadata Service application connects into the web application level. Web applications can be connected to multiple Managed Metadata Service applications. The Managed Metadata Service application being consumed by a web application can be local to the farm or remote. Additional options for the connections include specifying the default location for the term set, the default location for a column-specific term set, and the hub for content type publishing. Enterprises wanting to interact with digital assets and resources by way of metadata applied to the item often find that the inability to manage, share, update, or restrict metadata values from one or more centralized services in the enterprise makes it so that items have inconsistent or unreliable metadata. Managed metadata service applications enables users to create, delete, merge, reuse, deprecate, describe, translate, and define synonyms for metadata terms to be applied. A term is a word or phrase that can be associated with objects in SharePoint Server 2010. When a term is deprecated, the term persists in the term store but cannot be used in future applications of metadata. An open term set is defined as a term set that is available for users with the correct permission to add terms. When a term is reused, the term that was created in one term set is included in additional term sets. When terms are merged, the target term is the term that persists after the two terms are merged. When talking about scale, the targets were 1 million objects per term store. That includes terms, term sets, and groups, not 1 million terms. There can be 30,000 items per term set and 1,000 term sets maximum. These are the tested supported scale points, and we only support maxing out one axis of these three values. Typical scenarios include building hierarchical structures of terms known as term sets. Each term in the hierarchy can have many term labels to represent synonyms of a term. A term can also be translated, and for each supported language, have a collection of synonyms. Once hierarchies are created, they can be consumed by users in the form of term sets. For example, assume that your company has locations and regions. To implement this, you would define terms based on each of the office locations. Group these terms into a term set called locations. Create four new columns: country, region, state, and city. Specify that the value or values for each of these columns must come from the locations term set. Associate these four columns with the content type that represents the documents. In this example, whenever a user creates or uploads a document to a SharePoint Server 2010, the user would have to select the person or people who are associated with the document in each of the four roles. If the company adds a new location, you would add a new term to the locations term set, and it would become a valid value for all four columns. The term store contains groups of term sets. Each group allows for different user ACLs, and each term set is a hierarchy of terms. Terms can coexist in different locations of the hierarchy within different term sets. Term sets also allow for custom sort order as well as unique settings for the availability of a term or the entire term set. This allows for greater flexibility when different divisions or sections of an enterprise have specific and differing expectations and needs of the metadata hierarchies. A term store is unique to a service application and is made of groups, which in turn contain term sets. Each term store maintains settings for languages, including a default language. Permissions. Each term store also has settings that control whether it is partitioned or unpartitioned. Each group allows for different ACLs to be set in order to control the users who have permission to edit and manage the term sets. Now we'll do a demonstration on the use of the term store.
In this demonstration, we're going to take a look at the term store management tool. As I mentioned in the lecture portion of the session, we have the notion under the term store of the management of data service itself, and underneath we have a group, which is a term group. I've manually created this term group called corporate taxonomy. And then the system automatically created one for keywords, which was all the keywords that have been added through enterprise keywords feature and various locations where people have tagged them. As long as the term set itself is open, then they get dropped into the keyword section, and then also there's orphan terms. So let's take a kind of a deeper look at each of these. So within the corporate taxonomy term group that I created, notice I have a group name for it. I have the ability to set a description for it. I can also set different group managers to be a part of it. So let's go ahead and look for an individual to make a part of this particular term group. Okay, there's Brad. I'm going to go ahead and add Brad. And then I can also set a series of people that are able to come in and actually contribute. And these users have full permission to edit the terms and the term hierarchy sets, but they can't necessarily modify the permissions for the term set itself. So I'm going to go ahead and save that. I don't currently have a term set underneath, so I can create a term set. One of the other things that I can do is I can import a term set. So if we go back to the root of the Manage Metadata service and we take a look, we can see that currently in terms of who can actually administer this term store, currently the Contoso administrator is the only one. The default language is currently set to English. But let's take a look at this import file that we might use to import a term set. So as you can see, this is the format of the Manage Metadata import file as viewed through Excel. Let's look at it another way as well. I use Notepad to take a look. You'll notice a couple things about this particular sample. It is a comma-separated file. So the very first line in there is a required line, and it's essentially defining the schema and the way that the rest of the file will be imported. So on that very first line, you can see it's defining that term set name, then term set description, the LCID for the language ID, whether or not the item is available for tagging, the term description, and then a level 1 term, level 2 term, level 3 term, and so on and so on, showing the actual hierarchy of the terms that are brought in. The comma after the name of the term set is required. So in this particular case, political geography is the name of the term set. There's a comma afterwards. Then there is a description of the term set right here, followed by two commas to indicate that that's the end of the term set description. And then also you'll notice the word true or the word false could be there, and that indicates whether users should be able to add the terms in this term set to items throughout SharePoint. If you don't provide a value for this, for the available for tagging, the term set is automatically available for tagging. Then immediately following, you can see I've got an actual term description, and then within that term description I have continent. But at the end of that particular line, designating the end of that term line, is exactly 8 commas. So let's go back here. So on this third line, you'll notice that the third line of the Manage Metadata import file, and each successive line represents a term. We separate the values in the third line and in each successive line with commas. You can omit an optional value, but you can't omit the accompanying comma for that optional value, because commas are required as separators regardless of whether the values are present. The values in the line represent the information that I mentioned before. So the term set name, the term set description, the locale identifier, if it's available for tagging, the term description, and then the hierarchy of terms. So in this particular example, it's a little bit easier to look at it in Excel. So, and it is a lot easier to actually manipulate these in Excel as well. So, because Excel has the ability to save it back as a comma-separated format using the schema. So in this case, there's my term set name of political geography. Here's my term set description. Here's the LCID, which doesn't currently have a value. It's available for tagging, the term description. The level 1 term, in this particular case, it's continent. And then here's a level 2 term, a level 3 term, level 4, and we don't have anything out to the 5th. Well, there we do right there. And here's all the way to that. So we can we could back in the term store, import it, but what we're going to do instead is I've pre-created a couple other term sets. Right here I have one that is product categories, so let's take a look at it. I also have another one that is company sizes, confidentiality import term set, currencies, and geography. The reason I have these broken out is whenever we do the import into the managed term store, or into the taxonomy term store, we have to do them into an existing group, and we also can only do one term set at a time using this import method. So let's go ahead and import one of the files that I actually have by choosing to do an import term set. And we'll go ahead and start off by using the product categories term set. And as you can see, it's relatively quick. We now have a term set called product categories. We've got a term underneath it called differentials. And then we have some hierarchy in terms of gears. So we've got a whole series of things there. Let's take a look at options in the way of a term set. So we can define the name. Here was the description that we talked about. Currently the owner of this particular term set is the administrator. We can also specify an email address for suggestions or feedback on a specific term throughout the product. We can also specify stakeholders, which are the users that may be interested in changes or information about the taxonomy itself, which in this particular case would probably be a good idea to put Brad Sutton in here as well. And currently, the submission policy is that it's closed, meaning this is a closed term set, and right now, the only individual that can go in and modify this term set is currently the Cognoso administrator. Now Brad can actually see the changes, but if we go up here and take a look. So let's go ahead and first off save this. Notice there's also a check for available for tagging, which we had specified in our import file. Let's go back up here and look. So Brad is a group manager. So he can manage their permissions if he was logged in to actually modify who the stakeholders are and the owners and things of that nature, so Brad actually could. We're going to go ahead and keep it closed because, again, this is the corporate taxonomy, unlike the keywords, where this is the free flow type of tagging that is occurring as people are entering it. So remember, earlier I went ahead and added the new enterprise keyword of acquisitions, and you can see that particular keyword's right there. You can also see that I could move it to a different location. I could also delete it right there if the keyword was offensive. So if we go back up and we take a look at this again, same thing holds for the individual terms, except that we can do a little bit more since they're not enterprise keywords and they're actually managed terms as part of that corporate taxonomy. I can create a new term that would show up underneath it in the hierarchy. I can also copy a term. I can reuse terms. I can merge terms from another location. I can also deprecate a term or move it or simply delete it. So as you can see right now, differentials by way of being a term is currently available for tagging, so users will see it throughout the product. They can also see that it is currently in English. I don't have a description for it, which would be a good idea. I can add a label, and a label is a synonym for a term. So I could add an additional synonym. But for now, let's go ahead and switch over to where we have a document. And you'll notice that right now, because we only have the enterprise keyword, we don't necessarily see that. But if we were to go and edit the properties, and we start typing here, one of the things that shows up from the corporate taxonomy is actually differentials. So as part of that new term set I added to the corporate hierarchy, it is available from product categories to be used to tag this particular document. So kind of a way to get the right words in the right places to begin the tagging process for users. I'm going to go ahead and cancel that. As I mentioned before, I could just manually at this level do another new term set. But let's go ahead and import some more terms. Let's go ahead and import company sizes. So you can see now I have company sizes, and I've got those. And again, I followed just the same approach that was in the standard schema that I showed you. But notice how it imported as a new term set with a series of terms underneath it. Let's import a few more. We're going to go ahead and import a levels of confidentiality. We'll do some currencies. And finally, we'll do some geographies. Now, this geography list that I'm about to import, or a set of terms, has over 3,600 locations, so 3,600 locations, as I recall. It's a relatively large amount, but one of the reasons that I wanted to do this as a demonstration is to show that in this particular case, I do have some invalid options at the bottom. However, it's going to go ahead and bring the bulk of the items in. So it is relatively robust in terms of pulling the information in, even if there are problems. And you can see that I've got a relatively deep hierarchy with this particular file. Now, the nice thing, as I mentioned before, is that all of these options are going to show up later if I were to go in and try and tag or edit something within the product. So, for instance, if I type A, you can see that I can narrow it down to Afghanistan or some of the different ones. The users also get a chance to take a look at the geography itself. So, if I select that particular location, it's automatically brought in. And I get the same options within the Office client as well.
A new column type is available when you define a column in a SharePoint list. That is the Manage Metadata column. The user provides a name for the column and specifies the column type to be Manage Metadata, and provides and selects the term set to pull from the Manage Metadata service application. When you want users to provide information for list items, including documents, and the valid values for the information are contained in a term set, use a Manage Metadata column. This is the tie-in to taxonomy or hierarchy that is used in the term store. You can also create a new content type or modify an existing content type and add the Manage Metadata column to that content type. This allows for a consistent deployment of the Manage Metadata column to sites needing to consume it. Now we're going to view a demonstration of the Manage Metadata column.
Now that we've actually gone and added several terms into the term store, let's see how things can change in terms of the Manage Metadata experience. I mentioned that we have a new column type called the Manage Metadata column. So we're going to go ahead and add that column to this particular document library. So go to Library Settings. I'm going to go ahead and create a column. I'm going to call it Geographies. I'm going to choose Manage Metadata. It gives me the option to require that this column contains information. I'm going to say no. Enforce unique values, no. Add it to the default view. I'm going to go ahead and allow multiple values for it. The display value is going to show the term label in the field rather than displaying the entire path to the term in the field. So for example, it's not going to show me the hierarchy. It's going to show me just the single value of city, like is in the example here, versus location, continent, country, region, city. The other thing you'll notice here is I have the ability to specify a term set. Now, if I had a large taxonomy, I could actually search down into the taxonomy to find the term set I was looking for. My particular case, it's small enough. I'm going to go ahead and browse into the actual taxonomy that I've created. And in here, I have company sizes, confidentiality, currencies, and geography, all the same term sets that I had before underneath the corporate taxonomy group. In addition, I also have this site collection that has one called Wiki Categories, which was another one that was created earlier. But let's go ahead, since I'm specifically targeting geography, and I'm going to leave it at that one. I don't have any desire to customize the term set, although I could. And we're not going to do any default values, and I'm going to go ahead and click OK. And now when we go back to the shared document library, one of the other things that you'll notice here is that I also have geographies as a column. So if I choose to edit the properties now, you can see I now have that Manage Metadata column for geographies. And let's go ahead and, since this is, you know, Trey Research is a US-based firm, let's go ahead and do the United States. We'll go ahead and save it. And now this document is in the US. Let's also go ahead and add another document. I'm going to go ahead and add the corresponding press release for that particular announcement. Now when I go to add that, I have the option to set a title and also set enterprise keywords as well. So in this particular case, we'll call it the Trey . We'll also use the acquisition keyword. And under geographies, as before, this doc is related to the same acquisition, but if it wasn't, we could go ahead and say that it was, let's say, from Afghanistan. I've saved the document. And now, as I mentioned, since we actually have this Manage Metadata on these different documents, in addition to making it easier to use keywords to find it in search, we can also filter this particular document library based on this managed metadata. So if I come up here to geographies and I say show me options that are only from Africa, I would I'd be narrowing down that particular view. So in this particular case, let's go ahead and clear the filter. So since Afghanistan is actually in Asia as opposed to Africa before, you notice that none of the documents showed up. But if I come back and I choose geographies and then I go to Asia, or I go to let's say North and Central America, and I choose to include descendants, then I start to get the information back the way I want. So I've filtered down to the documents created in the United States, and let's say I want to go ahead and do Asia, then there I have the Afghanistan document, because I am including any descendants from that particular managed metadata. Let's also take a look at how, now that we have the managed metadata column, how that would change things with the client, in the Office client. So if I take this particular file offline and say edit in Microsoft Word, or pull it down from SharePoint, I should say, take a look at the information, you can see I have enterprise keywords here. Specifically, I have acquisitions. You can see I have some of the other metadata properties there as well. And notice here that geographies is the column, and there's the value. So I could come in here using the picker, and I could get very specific about where in Afghanistan I was talking about. So I could actually come in and change this specifically to Kabul. So not only Afghanistan, but also Kabul. And go ahead and save that. And then I'll go ahead and exit Word. And you can see that now I have both of them. So in this particular case, when I go to do things, if I choose to exclude descendants, both go away. If I choose to include descendants, or I choose to further refine it, now I can see that particular document in the filter, because I filtered specifically down to documents that are in the geography of Kabul.
When we compare the managed metadata column type with the enterprise keywords column, both have the ability to have single or multiple values for a specific field. The enterprise keywords is not contained in the base document content type, nor is the managed metadata keyword. However, we can have multiple managed metadata columns in a single content type or library, whereas we can only have one enterprise keywords column per content type. In addition, we can use inclusive and exclusive filtering with managed metadata columns. Whereas enterprise keywords, we essentially get the entire list. However, enterprise keywords are available to validate against all term sets in the term store. Managed keywords are also typically used in building folksonomies, or systems where users have the ability to tag and add information at will to various documents or items in a list. The managed metadata column is multi-user interface enabled, has a most recently used and a tree picker control. Both support autocomplete, and both will provide a preferred term. So what are the benefits of using managed metadata? First of all, it provides a more consistent use of terminology. Managed metadata facilitates more consistent use of terms. You can predefine terms and allow only authorized users to add new terms. You can also prohibit users from adding their own managed keywords to items and require them to use existing ones. By presenting only a list of the correct terms from which users can select values, greater accuracy is maintained. Also, by encouraging users to provide metadata for various items, better search results and better navigation filtering is available. Also, since managed metadata is almost a super choice column, it allows for contents to grow dynamically without having the need to modify the choice field as in previous versions of SharePoint when new words become available. Now we're going to discuss content type publishing. Content type publishing allows for an up-to-date version of the same content across the SharePoint farm or farms. By designating a hub through the Managed Metadata Service application, one publishes the content type once, and it is pulled by the subscribing site collections from the hub. This allows for a consistent use of policy and reuse across the site collection and farms, and gives the user a truly enterprise content type. Organizations can now share these content types across site collections or farms in their SharePoint deployment. To set up content type publishing, you must configure an instance of the Managed Metadata Service application to designate a specific site collection as the enterprise metadata hub for content type publishing. Other sites or farms can then establish connections to this Managed Metadata Service application and subscribe to content types. With content type publishing, a central location can be used to make content types available to the subscribing galleries. After a content type has been published, it becomes read-only on the subscribing sites. Site owners for subscribing sites can use the content type as is by adding to it or adding it to lists or libraries, or they can extend it by creating new site or list content types that are based on it. When the published content type is updated in the site content type gallery of the hub site, the updates can be republished to the subscribing site. Content types are published from a normal site collection, site content type gallery, meaning that you don't have to create a special, you don't have to use a special site definition to create a site that can be a hub. Any site collection, specifically the site content type gallery, can act as a hub. We can have a maximum of one hub per metadata shared application service. It is not a requirement that a metadata service application syndicate content types, meaning you don't have to turn on content type publishing. It is not a requirement that a service connection consume content types from a service. So just because I have a managed metadata service application available and serving up content types does not mean that I have to consume content types from that service. I could have it simply acting as a term store. Setting a site collection to be the hub enables the necessary components on that hub. Each consuming site collection, all site collections in a web app that have a connection, will produce a local error report for use in troubleshooting if content type publication fails. The metadata service application syndicating the content types can choose to gather error logs from all the consuming site collections at the hub. Consuming site collections have a report to see which content types are being consumed from each service application. The location of content type publication hub, that is the URL of the site collection that contains content types that are shared for usage, is also available through central administration. the content type packages that contain the definitions of these content types. Or content type packages contain the definitions of the content types stored in the hub. A log for issues encountered during content type publication, and a setting controller and a setting controls whether errors are logged or not. Multiple sites can be configured as hubs for content type publishing, so it is possible for sites to subscribe to and receive published content types from more than one hub. Publish content types to make them available for use on subscribing sites. Republish content types to push updates to subscribing sites, and it is possible to unpublish content types, although with the mantra of do no harm, unpublishing a content type does not remove data from a previously consuming subscriber. By helping to ensure a consistent taxonomy, the terminology used in SharePoint is consistent. Navigation and filtering based on metadata make it possible to filter or navigate to specific content faster than by browsing folders. It also helps in using archiving, retention, and deletion policies for content. This helps reduce costs by keeping the collaboration environment light in terms of storage or organized in the case of records. More metadata means better search results. It also assists in providing more synonyms for users to reach the content they need rather than memorizing a static list of terms. Put this together with the multiple ways you can apply metadata in SharePoint 2010 and Office 2010, and you have a reduction in training for getting the right terminology applied. This reduces the complexity of workflow and gives a user motivation to complete an otherwise thankless task. Now we're going to see a demonstration of content type publishing.
Now we're going to take a look at content type publishing. One of the first things that we'll have to do is make certain that a content type hub has been specified as part of the managed metadata service application. So first off, let's go ahead and check that. So we'll go to Manage Service Applications. We'll go to the Manage Metadata Service. We're going to go to Properties. You can see some of the information that we specified earlier. And I previously had gone in and specified the content type hub of http://intranet.contoso.com. I can also tell it to report error messages here as well, so I'm going to go ahead and click OK. So I do have one specified. That particular team site can be found here. It's one of the ones that we've used through several of the demos. Let's take a look at some of the content type settings. Specifically under Site Collection Administration and Content Type Publishing, you can see that since this particular site collection and also web application are associated with this managed metadata service, the one that I've been working with, you can also see that the intranet.contoso.com content types location is the hub. Now I'm currently in the hub, so I'll go ahead and take a look at that. We're going to manage contents. Now, I previously created a very simple content type. All it has, it's a standard content type inheriting from announcement. I've added two custom columns to this particular content type, anniversary and birthday. And one of the options that you'll notice that I have for this content type is I can actually manage the publishing for this content type. So I'm going to go ahead and click that. I currently have not published this, so there's no last published date, and my option is to publish it. I can't unpublish it because it's never been published, and I can't republish it because I haven't made any modifications to it. So for now, I'm going to publish it for the first time. I'll click OK here. This is now one of the content types that's being published. I also have another site. I've created, which is the content type consumer site. I'm going to go ahead and open that one. I'm going to go to the site settings. I'm going to scroll down in this site collection to the content type publishing. And that's going to redirect me back up to the hub. So that's important to note that currently nothing's been subscribed to, but this just links me right back up to the hub where it should. So where would I find the content type that I just published? Well, in this particular site collection, since it's one that's in the hub, I would go to site content types, and it would be one of the ones that's populated into this particular folder, as it would these are currently, as you can see, that the source for these is currently the content type consumer, which is the name of my site. You don't currently see the one for my demo content type because the job hasn't completed yet. So let's go ahead and refresh this page and see if the content types have come down from the content type hub. And when we look, the content types have come down from the content type hub and are available in the site template gallery. I can then use those on this particular site as though they were native to it. Again, if we go take a look at the settings that we had, one of the things that you can do if you're doing some testing and you want to actually push down the jobs or make the jobs occur quicker, is you can go to the monitoring page and then specifically the content type hub job, and you can choose to run now. The other job is the content type subscriber job, which is scheduled to run at some point here. We'll find it really quick. Normally it is going to go off, I believe, about every 15 minutes. There it is. It's actually hourly, and so then I can run that. Now, one of the other important things to check when you're configuring site content type publishing is if we go back to the managed service applications and then specifically down to the actual properties here, not the properties of the service application, but the properties of the connection itself, we need to make sure that we have enabled the pushdown content type publishing updates from the content type gallery to subsites and lists using the content type. And the other one, if we want to actually pull those content types and make them available, is to make sure that we consume content types from the content type gallery up at this particular location. And that was my content type hub. So that gives you an idea of ways that you can pull down content types and you publish them over to different locations and different site collections throughout the farm, and even across the farm if I had another farm set up to show you.
I hope you enjoyed this Ignite session.